Hello friends, my name is Mohsin Mulla and I welcome you all to this video lecture. So today we are discussing one very important topic of unit 2 of industrial automation and control subject. The topic that we are discussing is flow measurement. Accurate measurement of flow rate of liquids and gases is an essential requirement for maintaining the quality of industrial processes. In fact, most of the industrial control loops control the flow rates of incoming liquids or gases in order to achieve the control objective. As a result, accurate measurement of flow rate is very important. Like in the beverage industries and petrochemical industries, which are largest industries which will be continuously processing the fluids in order to make the most efficient and high quality products, they need to monitor the continuous flow rate of the fluids in the various systems. Therefore, there is a grave need of highly accurate and efficient measuring instruments for the measurement of flow rate. So therefore, let us see the various types of flow meters that are most commonly used in various industries. The very first is obstruction type, so which is again differential pressure or variable area type. So next is inferential type, where it is like a turbine type. Then based on electromagnetic principles, then based on sound wave, that is ultrasonic sensors are used. Then there is anemometer, which is used commonly, we have seen, for used for wind velocity measurement. Then finally, for the measurement of solid flow, so we have Coriolis principle based flow mass flow meter. So now in the next sections we are going to see all of these different types of flow meters one by one. So now let us first see the obstruction type flow meter. Obstruction or head type flow meters are of two types: differential pressure type and variable area type. So differential area type, differential pressure type basically uses difference in the pressure at two different places for the measurement of the flow rate. Now this particular type meters are orifice meter, venturi meter and pitot tube type of flow meter, while rotameter is of the variable area type. But in all these cases, the obstruction is created in the flow passage and the pressure drop across the obstruction is related with the flow rate. So now to understand that, let us see the theory of fixed restriction variable head type flow meters. In the variable head type flow meters, a restriction of known dimension is generally introduced into pipeline. Consequently, there occurs head loss or pressure drop at the restriction with increase in the flow velocity. Measurement of this pressure drop is an indication of the flow rate. For example, in this picture, so there is a continuously flow of fluid from one side, and suddenly in this pipe there is a obstruction created. If suppose there was no obstruction available, then all the liquid or fluid will be flowing in this way and with the same velocity and at the same pressure exerting on the walls of the pipe. But since one obstruction is created in between the pipe, so here the velocity at this juncture is reduced, and because of this small opening, all of high pressure is created at this obstruction area, and this side, because of that high pressure, the fluid forces with high velocity outside this particular opening. Therefore, at this place, the velocity is high and pressure is very low. So the pressure at this juncture is measured, which is the very high pressure, is nothing but P1, and at this juncture also the pressure is measured, which is relatively low pressure. Now this pressure difference is going to help us to measure the flow rate. We can see this with the help of the following video. Hello friends, in this video let us see the differential pressure or head principle in flow rate measurement. Okay, so when we usually want to measure the flow rate of any fluid flowing in a pipe, so we have to use obstruction type of instruments, which will be using the drop in the head or the drop in the pressure as a way of measuring the flow rate. So now let us consider here a pipe with a cross section A, and there is a fluid flowing in this particular pipe at a density of rho, and it is moving with a velocity of v. Okay, so it is continuously moving in the pipe all the time, and when we want to measure the flow rate of this, so as per the formula, it is nothing but flow rate equal to velocity into cross sectional area. Okay, so now it is also true that at any two places in the pipe, if flow rate is measured, it is going to remain same. So this basic principle can be exploited further to obtain the flow rate. So now let us consider a obstruction in between the pipe, which is nothing but this orifice plate. Now this orifice plate will have a very small opening in the center, so which will be allowing the fluid to flow through it, and rest of the area will be blocking the flow of the fluid. So now the fluid is again flowing from this end, and it is coming up to the plate. Now it sees the obstruction, and the flow will it will reduce its velocity at this side of the plate, and with the small opening other side, with a very high velocity, the fluid will start coming out. Okay, so here you can imagine that there is a very high velocity compared to this side, and further the fluid is continuously coming at this side of the plate, and it is getting accumulated with a very low velocity, hence it is causing very high pressure on these walls. Therefore, let us say the velocity at this side is V1, and at the same time the pressure is P1. The pressure here is higher and velocity here is lower. Now on the other side of this orifice plate, here as the content of the fluid is smaller at this particular nearer area of the orifice plate, so therefore because of that the pressure is lower. So let us say that pressure is P2, and at the same time the velocity is very very high, which is V2. So now also we have to observe that this particular opening is having a cross sectional area of just A2. Okay, so therefore now here pressure is P2, and this side the pressure is P1, which is higher compared to P2. Therefore when we are using a pressure tube, so which is containing a fluid, so the fluid will be equal when the pipe is connected to the pipe like this, which is not having any obstruction. So here also and here also the pressure will remain exactly same, but in this case the pressure is different. Therefore the fluid will start moving from one side and it will come to the other side up to a particular level where the other side pressure is stopping it. So that is equilibrium situation. So therefore here the pressure is P2 and here the pressure is P1. So this level is measured, and this level is nothing but the loss in the head, which is indicated by H. H is given by P1 minus P2 divided by rho. So therefore this will give us the differential head or differential pressure. Now this can be used to measure the flow rate, as velocity is equal to V into K1 into root of H. So here K1 is nothing but the restriction constant. As we know that here there is A1, which is cross-sectional area of the pipe, and there is A2, which is the cross-sectional area of the orifice plate. So this cross-sectional area is smaller and this cross-sectional area is larger. So if we take the ratio of the two, so we'll get the restriction constant. A1 by A2 gives us K1, which is the restriction constant for the flow of fluid in the pipe. So therefore the flow rate is nothing but area times velocity. So substituting velocity as k1 into h in the above formula, we get flow rate is equal to ak1h, which therefore we get flow rate is directly proportional to h, which is nothing but flow rate is directly proportional to the differential pressure. Okay, so now with the help of that video, it is clear that how differential pressure can be used to measure the flow rate. So here is the first type of flow meter, which is orifice flow meter. So in this orifice flow meter, simply one obstruction is inserted, which is a plate. Obstruction is inserted, which is nothing but a plate. So that plate will be having a opening sorry. So that plate will be having a opening, for small opening to allow the fluid to pass through it. So that is what you can see in this picture. And as earlier explained, so at this place the pressure will be, which is P1, very high, and at this juncture the pressure P2 will be a very low pressure, and the velocity at this juncture is very high. Okay, so this velocity is high, and here the velocity will be reduced as there is a obstruction for the flow of fluid. So therefore, because of this difference in the pressure, a head is obtained between this P2 and P1. So that head will be used later to determine the flow rate as per the formula explained in the previous video. Okay, so now here it is the pattern of flow pattern of the orifice plate, and also here is the pattern of the flow for this orifice plate, and also there are different types of plates used. First one is concentric, then there is eccentric, where the opening is at different place than the center. Then there is another one which is a segmental, depending upon the type of fluid used, either this or this or this type of plate is used in case of orifice tube. Okay, so here is the animation of the flow meter, orifice flow meter. So clearly it is visible in this case. So there is a small opening and there is continuous fluid moving, and here it is getting narrower, and you can see here the fluid is moving with higher velocity, and here the fluid is very moving with a small velocity, and at the same time you can see here it is causing turbulences at this place and this place. It is causing turbulences. Now these turbulences are because of the blunt edges of the opening of this orifice plate. Okay, so now this is the big disadvantage of orifice plate type of flow meter. Now to overcome this type disadvantage, next type of flow meter is used, which is Venturi tube. So here what is done, so to avoid that blunt edge of the orifice plate, this much area is used as the measuring part of the flow meter. So where the throat is not just a blunt edge, but it is a total inlet area cone, and then there onwards again it is going to increase slowly. At this particular place we'll get the low pressure area, and because of the obstruction or the narrower throat here, we'll get high pressure at the earlier edge. So here we are going to high pressure, and here we are going to get the low pressure. Now again these two pressures are measured with the help of the pressure tube, and the differential pressure is obtained, and with the help of the formula obtained earlier, directly the flow rate can be indicated with the help of that pressure. So here is a constructional detail, you can refer it later. Then here is a small animation of the same orifice tube. So you can see that place where orifice plate was used is now replaced with the help of a elongated tube with a narrow area here, so conical shape. So now this is called as the Venturi tube. Okay, so now because of that there is no turbulences created in the pipe, which is a more safe way to measure the flow rate. And also here you can see a practical example of measurement of wind velocity. So at three different places the pressure tubes are placed in order to measure the pressure flow rate accurately. So here at the first place, and then there is the second place, okay, which will give us here, it will give us the pressure P1, and here it will give us the pressure P2, which is the lower pressure, and here it is going to be higher pressure. So as the velocity right now it is the low velocity, as the velocity increases you can see here the pressure will increase, and it will shoot above the here the baseline. Okay, so and also here it will come up to this particular line. So now we can measure this head, so that will give us one particular head of the pressure, and also similarly from this particular tube. So here also when the velocity increases it is going to change from one particular area to another area, so at that time there will be head. And here one particular tube is indicated which will show that, so when the there is no such type of arrangement made at that time, the pressure in this pressure tube will remain at the same level. So here also there is a pressure difference, so that we can observe. Okay, so with the help of multiple pressure tubes, the measurement of flow rate will be more accurate. Now next type of flow meter is pitot tube. So here simply one obstruction is used which will create a stagnation point in the middle of the fluid movement. Okay, so that stagnation point, so the velocity is almost zero and the pressure is very high. So this pressure whatever measured here is high pressure, and velocity at this juncture is exactly zero. Compared to the velocity that is available here, it is V1, and the nominal pressure or normal fluid pressure is P1. So now these two pressures P1 and P2 are very will play important role to measure the flow of the fluid flowing in this particular pitot tube. Okay, so this can be so here when a solid body is held centrally and stationary in a pipeline with a fluid streaming down, due to the presence of the body, the fluid while approaching the object starts losing the velocity directly in front of the body where the velocity is zero. This point is known as the stagnation point. As the kinetic head is lost by the fluid, it gains a static head. By measuring the difference of pressure between that normal flow line and that at the stagnation point, the velocity is found out. This principle is used in pitot tube sensor. The simplest pitot tube consists of a tube with an impact opening of 3.125 mm, and there is second pipe which will have a 6.35 mm diameter which will measure the nominal fluid pressure. So we can see this in next slide here. This measure the stagnation pressure. An ordinary upstream tap can be used for measuring the line pressure. So in this slide here, animated slide, we can see when the fluid is moving at this particular juncture, the velocity of the fluid is almost zero, but the pressure exerted at this point is very high. So because of that, here the fluid is completely moved toward the other pipe. Okay, so here, and this fluid will move up to this pipe. Now with the help of this opening here and this opening here, so continuously the nominal pressure is being measured. So that nominal pressure is measured at this particular level here. Okay, and the other pressure level is at this juncture. So say this is P1 and that is P2. So with the help of that P1 and P2, the head is calculated, and that pressure differential head will help us to determine the flow rate of this fluid here. So this is how the principle of pitot tube takes place in the actual measurement. Next is rotameter type flow meter, which uses wide area difference principle. Okay, so it is also obstruction type of meter, but it uses area difference. Okay, so what exactly happens in this type of measurement equipment is, so the fluid is allowed to flow from the bottom end and it will rise in the tube. Okay, and then it is allowed to go to the outlet. So when it goes upstream, at that time it is going to push upwards, the stream is going to push upwards. There is a float placed in the this particular cylindrical pipe. That float is circular in nature, like here spherical, and it is having a kind of a sharp edge, creates uniform turbulence which will help it to lift upwards. Okay, so the only pressure applied here is the gravitational force which will pull it downwards. Now depending upon the applied force from the stream, so depending upon the velocity, this is going to move upward, and whenever it is going to come and stop, so with the help of this indicator here, so that will be the direct indication of the flow rate in the fluid present over that particular pipe. So this can be explained with the help of this animation here. So initially the rotameter is there, it is placed at the bottom but as soon as the fluid starts moving, so it will lift it upwards, and this red mark wherever it comes and stops, so that will be the indication of the flow rate of this particular. So this is calibrated directly to give the flow rate. Okay. Now next one is turbine flow meter, which is also inferential type of flow meter. Here basically when the fluid is moving, so in between there is a obstruction created with the help of a turbine. So here the fluid, when it passes through the turbine, it also rotates the turbine. So when this turbine rotates, at that time there is a one particular magnet placed here which will come in contact with the pickup coil. So whenever this magnet comes in contact with the pickup coil, it is going to generate one pulse. Okay, so likewise, as the you can say flow rate is higher or the velocity is higher here, so the turbine will rotate faster and faster. So depending upon the velocity, so it is going to generate a number of pulses. Now depending upon the number of pulses per second, so we can determine the frequency, and that frequency is directly going to give us the flow rate. Okay, so that frequency is calibrated directly to give us the flow rate. So higher the flow rate, higher the frequency. Okay, so here is one animation to indicate the working of the turbine. So here is the pickup coil, and here is the turbine with one of the blade will be having a magnet to get a pulse to that particular pickup coil. Okay, so the turbine flow meter, so working is given here, so for your reference we can refer it later. Next is electromagnetic flow meter. Now here in the above all type of meters, obstruction is created in the flow of the fluid. So now if in order to avoid that obstruction, so we can make use of electromagnetic type of flow meter. It is going to be a little costly, but it is more efficient and more safer to be used in the measurement of the flow in the like dangerous fluids like sewer, while measuring the sewer, which is without being in directly coming in contact with the fluid, it can be directly measured. Even if the fluid is dangerous or the gases are dangerous, at that time also this electromagnetic flow meter will help us to measure the flow rate of the those dangerous gases. So basically the principle of this electromagnetic flow meter is Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Okay, so what does it say? So whenever a conductor crosses the magnetic field lines at perpendicular, okay, so at that time there will be an EMF induced in the conductor. Say this conductor is of the length L and it passes through this magnetic field of flux density B. Then when the conductor passes this magnetic field, at that time an EMF is induced in this particular conductor. So that induced EMF in the conductor is directly the measure of the flow rate of the fluid that is flowing through the pipe. So basically instead of this conductor here, the conducting fluid is made to flow through the magnetic field created by the two electromagnetic coils, so which are energized to produce the opposite poles. So okay, so because of the magnetic field created here, the conducting fluid will act as a conductor and it will have induced EMF in it. So that induced EMF is later measured, and we know that the formula to measure the induced EMF in a conductor is given by E equal to B into L into V. Okay, so now we know all these parameters: magnetic flux density, then length of the conductor, velocity of the conductor. So here the volume flow rate Q is given by Q equal to pi d square by 4 into V, where d is diameter of the pipe, V is average velocity of flow, here the conductor velocity. Now we have the formula. From earlier formula we can derive V equal to E divided by BL. So therefore Q is nothing but pi d square by 4 into V. Substituting that E divided by 4 BL, E divided by BL, we will get Q equal to pi d square E divided by 4 BL. So taking all of the constant size K, so we get directly flow rate equal to K into E, where K is a constant, therefore Q is directly proportional to induced EMF. So induced EMF will directly give us the flow rate of the fluid. So here is the working diagram of that electromagnetic flow meter. So here AC supply is connected to one electromagnetic coil on this side and another electromagnetic coil this side. So this will be continuously producing the magnetic field between the two, and this is nothing but the circular pipe. Okay, so in this circular pipe, so magnets are placed here and here these coils are placed, so there is continuous magnetic field and fluid is moving like this, and that fluid is conducting in nature. Now whenever that conducting fluid is moving, so it is also coming in contact with these two electrodes connected on the other side. So these two electrodes will pick up the induced EMF in the conductor, and with the help of this isolation transformer, that pickup signal of the induced EMF is supplied on the secondary side. Now this secondary side coil is directly connected to the pulse amplifier. So here this lower section is basically for the balancing and the calibration of the electromagnetic meter. If you neglect this, still it is very clearly understandable. Okay, so this part is directly connected to the amplifier, and that amplifier will amplify the whatever pulse is coming, and depending upon the magnitude of that pulse, so there will be the rotation of the servo motor. So servo motor will indicate us the, so as the voltage will be higher, the servo motor will rotate for the larger value, so that will indicate the larger flow rate. And if the flow rate is lower, the EMF will be lower and it will indicate the lower value like this. So directly the value of this flowing fluid will determine the value of the flow rate here. Okay, so it is like this. So with the help of animation also we can see this. This is the theoretical part of that, you can refer later. So now here two animations are there to understand. So here in the first animation you can see the location of the magnetic coils as well as whatever signal is being produced, that signal is being detected with the help of these two electrodes here, and other side also there is one electrode. Okay, so these two electrodes, okay, so these are being picked up by this particular line here. So inside this housing, so there will be that pulse amplifier which will be directly, so now in this particular case it is a digital meter, so no need to measure it with the help of the that analog type of meter. It will directly give us the value in digital reading. So here you can see the conducting fluid is moving in between the magnetic field, and here these two are carrying that magnetic field, EMF induced up to this particular point here. Inside that is an amplifier, and further that amplifier will directly indicate us the rate of flow of that particular fluid flowing in that particular pipe. Okay, so this is how the electromagnetic type of flow meter works. Now there are some peculiar advantages of electromagnetic flow meter. Okay, so the first one is the obstruction to flow is almost nil here. So therefore in this type of meter there is no need for kind of obstruction, and therefore it can be used for measurement of heavy suspensions including mud, sewage and wood pulp, which rather will be very difficult in the case of obstruction type of flow meter. The next one is there is no pressure head loss or any other kind of problem, so which is usually incurs in case of the other type of flow meter measuring methods. So here there is no head loss or reduction in the particular value of the pressures at any point of the time. They are not very much affected by upstream flow disturbances, so it is not at all being affected by any kind of flow. Either side it can work, upstream or downstream, it doesn't make any difference to this type of meter. They are practically unaffected by variation in density, viscosity, pressure and temperature, since the conducting medium directly links with the kinetic velocity with which it is moving. So it doesn't matter what viscosity it is having, what density it is having, still we can get the clear reading of the flow of that medium. Next is electric power requirement is also very low here, 15 to 20 watt. Okay, Then these meters can be used as a bidirectional meter. Either side it can be used, while in other type of meters it is not possible to use in either direction. Then these meters are suitable for most acid bases or water and aqueous solution, because these metals are not only good electrical insulators but also are corrosion resistant. Okay, so this can be used in that case. Okay, they are capable of handling extremely low flow rates. So even for the very low flow rate, there will be still EMF induced in the moving conducting medium. Okay, so next one is sound-based flow meter. Here also there is no obstruction created, but instead a sound wave is used for the measurement of the flow rate. Here the basic principle is, when the fluid is moving from this direction to that direction, it is moving with certain velocity. Okay. When there is no fluid moving at that time, this sensor A, transducer A, and will generate a sound signal. Okay, so that sound signal will travel from here and it reaches here, so at a fixed time. So here there is this is called as transit time. So this transit time will be fixed time. Okay, it is the normal time that it will take for the travel of the sound signal from this end of the transducer to the other end. But now when there is a flow in the fluid at that time, what will happen? Due to the flowing fluid, the sound will not go in this straight line, but it may take a different path and then it reaches to the signal. So because of the other transducer, because of that, the time here will increase. Okay, so at this time the time here will be increased, or rather it will decrease, because here the sound signal is not traveling opposite to the fluid, but it is going to flow with the fluid. So therefore it is going to increase in the velocity, therefore it reaches in the short time. So here this particular time T1 will be less than the actual transit time. In the same way, when the other transducer B gives a sound signal, it will travel in the upstream direction. It will be opposing the flow of the stream. If the flow is like this, so this is the downstream, and here if the sound signal has to move from this point to this point, it is upstream. So at this particular time, this sound signal, whatever is generated by the transducer B, will take more time, T2, than the transit time. So now whatever time difference will be there, so that time difference will give us, so the time difference T2 minus T1 will give us, in normal case these two will be same T, okay, but in this particular moving fluid it will be different. So T2 will be larger than, which is due to B, will be larger than T1, which is smaller time due to A, transducer A. So this difference directly gives us the measurement of the flow rate. So the theoretical part is also given here. So here it is given T A to B, then T B to A. So how the here time decreases and how the time here will increase, so that is given. And then there is delta T, which is the difference. So with the help of that, the velocity is estimated here. So that is the direct relationship between the velocity. So here there is a animation of the that ultrasonic sensor type of meter. So you can see here, so one is giving signal against the stream, another one is giving in through the stream. Okay, so because of that, so there will be transient time difference that will help us to measure the velocity of this flowing fluid. Okay, so finally the anemometers, usually we have heard the name, as we are using this to measure the wind velocity. Normally handheld anemometers are available, but here basically we are going to see as a principle different type of anemometers. So here first one is hot wire resistance type of anemometer. Okay, so basically what is done here, a hot wire is used which is actually having supplied with the electricity. Okay, so now because of the flow of the electricity, it will be glowing, so it will have a certain temperature. Now when the fluid is not moving, so the temperature is not going to change, therefore the resistance is not going to change. Okay, Now, as the fluid starts moving with certain velocity, so now because of the kinetic motion of the fluid here, particularly air, so this filament is going to get affected by that moment of the flowing air. So therefore it is going to get reduced in the temperature. Therefore that reduction in the temperature is going to indicate directly the that reduction in the temperature will give us the directly the measure of the flow rate. Okay, reduction in T is the flow rate. So this is the basic theory part of that. Then next one is the mechanical type of anemometer. So here basically it is like a simple wind generator. So here three cups are cup type of anemometer, which three cups are connected here. So when these three cups are rotating, at that time it will generate a pulse. So for each rotation, so those number of pulses per second will directly give us the wind velocity. Or also we can use this for the measurement of other type of flue gases. We can use this in the we can say exhaust pipe in the large factories and all. At that time it will give us the flow rate of the smoke out of the chimneys. Okay, so here is the animation of the same. And then vane design anemometer. So this is more like analog type of anemometer, but recently we do not use this type of anemometer and it is not even found generally in the applications. So this is what is used nowadays, handheld digital anemometer, but still it uses the vane design. So vane design is simply here a fan is used, so which is going to continuously rotate, and that rotation is converted into the velocity here. So this will give us the velocity of the wind depending upon the rotation of the fan. Okay, so this is vane design anemometer. And then Coriolis mass flow meter. So this particular type of flow meter is used for the measurement of mass, which is little bit like a sludgy type of material. Okay, where you can say the viscosity is very high. So at that time this type of flow meter is used. Basically here what is used is with the help of this animation we can understand, as the actual diagram are not that clearly indicating the operation. So in these slides you can see, so basically first this particular pipe, okay, so I'm trying to highlight this area. So this section of the pipe is you can say excited with the help of a piezoelectric exciter, which will oscillate the pipe. So when it is not carrying any fluid, at that time it is going to oscillate at a particular, you can say, movement. Okay, so or in sync, both the sides at this side and this side will be in sync with each other. But as soon as the fluid starts moving, so here you can say there is a twisting effect. So that twisting effect will cause phase shift between this measurement and this measurement. These two sensors are continuously measuring that moment. So here we can see, so when these are carrying the fluid, at that time they are going to move in a you can say twisted manner. So because of that there is a phase shift. Okay, so here in this particular second diagram you can see, so the phase shift is directly the gives us the rate of mass flow. Okay, so basically when there is no fluid, at that time they are oscillating in phase, but when there is moment of the fluid in that, at that time they are going to oscillate out of shift. So the whatever quantity of out of shift value is there, so that will give us the measure of the flow rate. Okay, so this is how the mass flow is measured. Okay, thank you for watching this video.